So, I can't actually remember how far back this project started for sure in my head. Pre-2017, crazily enough, in the History of Hand Knitting by Richard Rutt, are some pictures and descriptions of relic bags from a church in Sion in Switzerland. There are 5 bags there and 1 from nearby Chur, and they think they were all done in the same workshop by the same person. I did interlibrary loan the German book from I want to say it's 1944? That could be 48 afterwards, of the gal who actually saw them. So that book has the actual pictures of all of the bags, unlike the History of Hand Knitting, where I'm not trusting some of his color descriptions. So it was very nice to have the actual source. One of them has, I want to say it's flowers on it, little balls above the tassels that are kind of Turkish knots with gold. That is the one I plan to recreate someday for Kingdom Arts and Sciences as one project. Another project will be more expansion on this, and a third will be all the other things that you can do with the byproducts. Oh. I've decided. Because I think it's kind of coming up on that. So in 2017, I bought the first mulberry plant and my roommate killed it. And it was too small. In 2016, I bought the next one and I let it grow. This was going to be a very long project. The year I finished these projects is the year I enter it, not before. When I started feeding these guys in spring, this was about the size of your average big leaf. Right now, I picked these off the tree last night. Oh. I did this a little early.
So the tree is 4 years old, 5 years old?
Yes. So here's the tree when I first got it, and tree right before I left last week. And that's with a trim. It's a weeping, so they just wanted to trail across the concrete. I actually had thought I bought a columnar, and I messed that up. So earlier this year, late April, I bought a batch of eggs and a batch of paste and 3 of these little cocooneries. Because I thought I was paying for 1, 2, 3, and I got 3 of these, which is fine. Instead of the 50 eggs I thought I was getting, I got about 8. So that was a lot. The butterfly house was not big enough. They had another secondary cage. I'll get to that in a second. Happenstance on Mother's Day. They hatched. Oh, and the eggs. There's some eggs in here. Hopefully those will hatch in time to be about a week old at Collegium. They may get sacrificed depending on how long the not frost lasts for this mulberry, we'll see. There are these, you can't really see here, but it's in the documentation. Tiny, tiny little specks. And 2 days later, this is a 1-inch grid that I just happened to have as a cutting mat on my desk. And they just grow, and they grow, and they grow, and they grow. And here's them before they get too big. And
what's he in?
He's in isopropyl alcohol. There's 2 of them in there. The green color is one of them had a bunch of mulberry in the gut that they smelled as they died. And replacing it still didn't really clean it out, so I have to actually put some more in.
That's what happens.
So they start out as those tiny worms.
So I don't wear it to school.
Right towards the end. So this is Tronchus maximus.
This is tiny?
This is Tronchus maximus.
Tronchus.
This is Tronchus, pride of her species.
Yeah.
She wanted to eat everything in sight. These little legs are called prolegs or crochets because they have gone. The back ones are the anal prolegs, which for some reason was hilarious to my husband and I. And they poop out these tiny little floret poops. Don't worry, it's been on the dehydrator. The other uses, there's a Chinese herbal remedy for several parts of the mulberry and for their poop. And I know people who've tried it, so yes, I will be trying one poop tea, watch this space. Because quite frankly, if Master Seamus and Mistress Eleanor found out I hadn't, they'd give me flack. Because that's how we all are. Oh, and
fermented tea.
Oh, this keeps going. This guy's, here he comes. Just to get ahead a bit, there he's just coming out of the cocoon. So he'll pop his little butt out. It took about 20 minutes of video that I had to just keep stopping and starting.
Oh my gosh.
So they last as worms about 30 days. The first one started cocooning on June 7th, so that tracks.
So I know you fed them a lot. How much do you know?
By the end, it was every couple hours.
Wow.
Of like, probably about a leaf per worm. Chonkis would stretch out across the whole worm and say, this one's leaf, and say, this one's mine. I would wake, my husband would wake up, go downstairs at about 9, feed them like a big handful of leaves. I'd come downstairs a couple hours later and I'd say, did you feed them? And he goes, yes, because they were just, wow. It was gone. I would feed them again their second breakfast, and that would last longer, maybe about 3 to 4 hours. And at 1 a.m. I was shoving leaves in before bed. They don't die, they just kind of just go, I'm not being fed, I'm not gonna do anything. And then they're very hungry the next morning. All of their water comes from the leaves. There are a couple other mulberry species they can eat. They don't get as good of silk. In a pinch, for a couple days, Osage orange is a food, but it is only the white mulberry that they eat. Let's see. So they came out, they cocooned. This is last year's batch. These are the ones that were allowed to emerge this year. There are 58 cocoons in my freezer waiting to be reeled. Spinning is a different technique that you would use if they're the ones that came out with the holes. You get a better quality of silk if they're not allowed to come out. And that is reeling. So it's not actually being spun, it's coming out as a long strands parallel. That's how it works. They also eat the pupae. Come see me at Collegium. There'll be a whole hour about this. We'll get to more things. That's not why we're not here for that part. And I've got some different species. As you might have seen from the Rivers Facebook group, there was, cocooning watch more and more every day. Chonkis was the last one to cocoon on June 13th. I was a little worried I was going to miss her coming out, but she was so late that was fine. While we were at Ontario West War, thankfully I have a Garmin InReach Mini that can text my husband while we have no service. So he was sending me things like, Chonk has not emerged, cocoon site of continued debauchery. Because they all just wanted to get it on her cocoon. Finally on July 3rd, Chonkis came out and he goes, Chonkis has emerged. Like, and I don't remember the exact words, but yeah, she was, it's in the documentation, she was very much getting it on. I have Chonkis here today. So they spend about 10 days in the cocoon. It's all going to be very average based on the environment. And then they spend 5 days as moths. They do not eat anything. Their job, frankly, ladies and gentlemen, is to have sex, lay eggs, and die. And that's it. So the whole process is about a month and a half. And this sounds like a crazy thing to do, but it's cheaper and shorter time than raising a sheep. And I haven't done the silk reeling yet, but I'm not good at spinning sheep. And the reeling is just, it's one consistency. I think I could just do that. And we're going to have a silk reeling party, actually, where my friends and I switch on and off because our arms are going to get tired. So it's going to be a group thing. Here's Chonkis right here.
Oh. Was she a bigger moth?
She is the biggest moth. Ah. That's how we could tell. You can see her right here in the middle. And so it was quite obvious. My husband wasn't sure later when I got home, but now that I sorted them out, I saw, she's the biggest moth. Yeah. That's why she's the pride of her species.
But her silk isn't.
No, her silk is in the fridge because all of the success. So there was two colors of eggs that came out. There was the pale yellow and the black, which are the fertile ones. And all of the fertile ones are on. It was the easiest way to put a bunch of eggs in the fridge was to put Chonkis's cocoon in the fridge. They need to stay in the fridge for at least 2 weeks to mimic winter. Then they can come back out and will take about 2 weeks to warm up and hatch and start the process. So hopefully those eggs that I just pulled out last night will be hatched by Collegium. The reason I didn't try to do another batch this summer was just, it's a very intensive process to feed them. And my husband was also involved. And there was a few trips to Labor Day weekend, I went to my parents' house for a week. So I wasn't gonna make him feed them for a week. You'll note that Memorial Day weekend, they went to my neighbor's house, who was the one that gave me the silkworms I raised last year that were older. And so I knew she could take care of them and I didn't have to have him worry about that because I didn't want to kill Chonkis. Oh, Chonkis wasn't actually identifiable at that point. They were all much smaller, but she got to be just a bit bigger. She was a bit lighter in color compared to the rest. And you looked in and go, yep, that was Chonkis. Eventually, as I said, we will reel them off. This is an example of the golden colored silkworms when they've been reeled off. I bought these from the gal that goes to Asia, who's been my mentor on learning how to do this. So it's very stiff because the sarracen is still there, so that will have to be cleaned. This will be my practice cleaning skin, basically. Here's some cocoons from other species. And think that's about it. Perfect. Other than more things I can spout off about that you can learn about in my talk at Collegium.
It feels a lot like London, a lot like Flax.